don't know which video it was. It was recent, though, that someone put a comment beneath. A question that was innocuous and totally fair to ask, but it's really stuck with me for some reason. And I always like the questions that stick with me.
Bag pre-packed. Dad packing.
The question levied was that of Piano Book, the MVP, the minimum viable product, and why, with a piano of 88 notes, loud, soft, pedal on, pedal off, long, short, would you sample it in just 12 notes? It's a perfectly fair enough question. To create an instrument just made up of 12 samples compared to that of one made up of maybe several hundred is surely going to be less characterful, less realistic than the detailed one. My argument would always be the reverse of that logic is actually true. And whilst you can achieve character and realism with hundreds of samples, it's a bloody sight more difficult. It's all about what I refer to as the cold, wet, dewy exponential rule of sampling. And that is, every time you add notes, you exponentially add to the workload. If you double the number of notes, which is still far from even diatonically sampling something, you will be doubling your transfer time, your editing, your noise reduction, and your implementation. It's not just the art of the recording itself, but the post-production. It is a boring and laborious process. We're only armed with a certain degree of concentration, and the minute mistakes creep into the workflow, that exponential load in post-production becomes often totally unmanageable. It's akin to cooking. When you're living on your own, you'll use the red cutting board that you cut the raw chicken on last night to make yourself a cottage cheese and salad cream sandwich. Don't mock me, it is the emperor of sandwiches. You'll maybe stick the knife into a tub of cottage cheese and lick it at the end and stick it back in. It doesn't matter, you're cooking for yourself. If you give yourself the shits, so be it. But when cooking for a loved one, you don't necessarily want to send them off to work with a rabid case of the squits. So you may use the whiteboard instead of the red board. Then when you have children, you have to be that much more meticulous. You have to boil everything. But when it comes to setting up a restaurant, a service, well, it goes into a new league. Fridge thermometers, hats, beard snoods, tabards, sterility. Whilst mistakes can render one's life into misery, sterility is something that's very difficult to return from and can actually render a sampling project completely unusable. But when people are playing music, the wonderful art of chaos comes into play. The faster, more difficult a piece, the less accurate the player. And us as listeners are used to hearing this. If you were to take a virtuosic violinist and analyse every note of a very quick and troublesome run they were to make, you would probably find that they weren't equally spaced and equally tempered. And indeed, if you were to correct that spacing and temperament, it would sound quite odd, not what we're used to hearing. That was not a perfect sunrise. Perfect sunrises aren't particularly interesting. Here's one. As today has demonstrated, in order to have a sunrise, it's good to see the sun. The perfect sunrises I've shown you are just sun. We've found that a little bit of cloud can be handy for the amazing changes in light that you get. But if the air is still, you don't get much movement in the cloud. So it's not just about a little bit of cloud, a little bit of sunlight. You want a bit of wind as well.
I'll always perpetually congratulate the Spitfire team. It really isn't me who makes the Spitfire samples. It never has been, with a few exceptions. But they'll work in these environments where perfection is what's being strived for, and clarity and purity. And they will try and engineer out of people musicality, performances. It's as much about our collaborations as well. And I guess when I do produce libraries that I'm attached to, Tundra, Neo, or indeed that felt piano that we recorded in the hall that will be coming soon, well, I kind of bring the clouds with me. So I'll sit there and there'll be a bunch of violinists wanting to give me that perfect G, and I'll go, yes, but make it misty. Quieter, quieter. No, you can play quieter than that. And therein lies the fragility, the aching heart, the humanity. Why just 12 notes and not 88? You may want to take, say, a Yamaha, no offense, Yamaha, you're wonderful, factory piano off the factory floor and tune it perfectly and mic it with a pair of pristine, like, 414s and do round robins and all 88 notes and seven dynamic layers. I guarantee you it won't sound as realistic as something recorded on an old SM58, someone's nan's old piano in Wolverhampton. I don't know why I say Wolverhampton, it's a perfectly nice place. And the reason for that is the investment of love. That piano has been played probably for decades. It has the imprint and the echoes of everyone who has played it. It has a story, regardless of... And that's what's special, I guess, about instruments and the way that they are played. I mean, in the case of a piano, it's all there in a cabinet for you. I think it's also really important to turn up. I have a little phrase for myself, and that is, good things come to those who wake. If you lay out an edifice that's too tall to scale, you will shy away from it. What I've worked out with these sunrise mornings is you can actually scale great heights provided you have a staircase. I start each day with a very finite ambition. That sun will not wait for me, so I propel myself up that hill. I come back, do a bit of editing, find a bit of music, put it up to Instagram. This means the rest of my creative day is, well, I hit the ground running. It's something that this weird self-imposed arbitrary challenge is going to give me for my future life. And it reminds me of when I was working with BT on Phobos. He said, oh, I have 15 years worth of loops. And I said, well, we can't use, you know, things from... He went, no, I make a loop every single day. It's almost like the creation of a haiku. So I think my last parallel with this sunrise collecting thing that I'm doing would be never to strive for perfection, because you may just achieve it and you may just find that disappointing. But strive. And not every day is going to be a great day, particularly at the moment. But if you do strive, one day you'll get one of these. Far from perfect, and of all the sunrises I've captured in this last very strange month, that'll be the one that I remember. I always get really nervous about these ones, which is why I probably make less of them these days, because I haven't edited it together fully, and I just don't know if it's going to make any sense whatsoever. So comments down below, more questions, I'll have a go. As always, subscribe if you haven't done so, ding that bell if you want to be notified the next time I put a video up, and one of those, always much appreciated. See you next time.